Heung-Min Son, the game-winning goal, 78th minute. Craig, I'm going to start with you. I think on yesterday's show, you said City had to beat themselves. Did they?
Not really. I mean, it wasn't like a capitulation that they had at Anfield last year that made the second leg nigh and impossible. But I don't think it was the greatest performance, don't get me wrong, by their standards. They still bossed the possession and the ball, and Tottenham were limited. Both teams were limited to good chances. You know, obviously Aguero missed the penalty. But it wasn't swashbuckling from City. But then again, I don't think 1-0 will be a huge disappointment for them. They did miss Bernardo Silva, who's been fantastic for them. And obviously a lot of people talking about no De Bruyne. He's on the bench. I think there's a reason for that.
Stevie, fair result?
I don't know that anybody deserved to win the game, to be honest. There weren't that many chances.
I thought City were a little passive when they had the ball. They had plenty of it. But going forward, you know, we used to see in the likes of Sterling and Bernardo Silva or Mahrez, you know, all these guys making runs in behind and City trying to pick those passes out. They seemed quite content just to keep a hold of the ball and never created that much for me. So I think they've paid for just being a little passive. You know, when you go away of what you do best, and for City that is absolutely possessing the ball, but going forward with a bit of pace and with a purpose, and they had none of that tonight.
It just felt like Manchester City were playing with the hangover of last year's result against Liverpool in the first leg. That they had that in the back of their mind, and that the way that Pep Guardiola approached the match was simply to say, you know what? We'll take a draw here. We'll take even a 1-0 loss here. We just don't want to give ourselves too much work for the second leg. And in doing so, I think you start playing not to lose rather than to win the game. When you do that, then you open yourself up for an opportunity to come the other way, and then you end up losing a match that you had under control, that you had a lot of the possession, but didn't really do anything with that possession. And when you do nothing really with the possession, then when you lose it in a bad area, now there's a counterattack that opens up. And from there, that's, I think, where Heung-Min Son is able to get in behind. Poor defending from Fabian Delph. I think it's poor goalkeeping from Ederson. And so a mistake on both areas, Delph and Ederson, you end up giving up a goal. Now you're down 1-0 in a game that I don't think if you're Manchester City, you should have been as passive as Stevie just mentioned or as conservative as Pep Guardiola was. The substitution of Leroy Sané and Kevin De Bruyne at 89th minute, I mean, what are we doing? Unless there are some fitness issues with these guys, if you're looking for a change of pace, man, those are the guys to bring on with 10, 15 minutes to go when Spurs were struggling a little bit because of the extended possession by Manchester City.
I can understand De Bruyne have been on the bench, though, not coming on as late as that, but I can understand him being on the bench because he's had a disruptive season with injury. He played in the Cup semi-final at the weekend, and this was always going to be an intense game. And I think there is still a bigger picture for Manchester City, i.e. the second leg, the title running. And so a lot of people are asking, you know, like, I've seen some of the questions that are coming in to to the tweet that you put out saying, why is De Bruyne not playing? And I think that's one of the reasons. Bernardo Silva, I think it just tells you how well he's played this season, Bernardo Silva, that he was certainly missed for Man City tonight. But on the other side of the coin, you know, OK, were City passive and a little bit negative by their standards? Or are we taking a lot away from Tottenham here, who were super organised both in defence and the middle of the park and really made it difficult for a City side that, in the previous games against Spurs, have created way more chances? So maybe a little bit of credit to Tottenham as well.
You feel like Spurs have done enough here?
No, I still think City...
We haven't even brought up Harry Kane goes off, you know, second half.
Well, not only did Harry Kane go off, but Dele Alli as well. So they're going to have problems replacing those two if they don't make it. But at the same time, if Manchester City go about it the way they normally do, I don't care if they're one down to Tottenham at home. They're going to beat them for me. That wasn't a bad team City put out. You know what? They're just lucky that they have De Bruyne and people like that to bring on. Mm. But the team they had out is a good team. Yeah, but I just think Pep Guardiola sent them out with the wrong message. I think that's the problem.
You agree?
Yeah, I, even in the pre-game questions that Guardiola is answering, even in the post-game conference that he obviously had to answer questions, everything was very understated about Pep Guardiola today. And I think that's what Manchester City was today, an understated version of themselves, which I suppose is okay if you finish 0-0, but now you're trailing. And even though 1-0 we would expect Manchester City to come back from it, now you're in a position that it's uncomfortable. At the very least, it's uncomfortable. It's not impossible like it was against Liverpool last year, but I do think that there was more in this game for Manchester City, and they just chose to take a more conservative path, which is unlike them.
At least it's going to be a great game at the Etihad. So I still think City will go through it. But at least now, I mean, without Harry Kane, it's a huge blow. But at least the tie is alive. However, when are we going to get to the big talking point?
The penalty.
When are we going to get to the thing that's got everybody's head banging against the wall?
It's early, and you guys, we're watching a match, and everybody in our green room is saying penalty.
Yeah.
And everything we're seeing on Twitter and television is saying no penalty.
Well, not everything.
Well, a lot of it.
A
lot of it. I mean, am I wrong? Am I overstating?
No, there are a lot of people out there, and you know, particularly back in the UK, the broadcasters that were covering it, some of the pundits just can't get their head around it. Mm. But if you slide out and your arm is up here, when has that never been a penalty? Never mind under the new UEFA directives, which clearly say it's a penalty. Mm-hmm. And we've got to forget, Bjorn Kuipers, the Dutchman, is one of the best and most experienced FIFA officials. He went over and looked at it, and he clearly thought it was a penalty kick under the new directives from UEFA. Now, in the second half, near the end, Danny Rose made a similar challenge and came out and slid and kept his arm by his side.
So it can be done.
So for those that are saying, oh, well, where's he supposed to put his arm?
There.
He did it in the second half, and he did it properly. It was a definite, for me, it was a definite penalty.
To be fair, it was all like former players that were making the case that this should not have been a penalty.
Which is bamboozling to me. You know, Craig's talking about the new rules and the saying that when that happens under the new rule. When I was playing, that was a penalty kick, and nobody argued about it. So I don't get where these former players are trying to talk about it's not a penalty. And by the way, what they should have been talking about is, why is Danny Rose lying on his back with his hand in the air anyway? You're supposed to make yourself bigger, not fall on your back. You should have been criticising him for the way he defended. And because he defended badly, he ended up on the back. And that's why his hand had to go out, because he had lost his balance.
Yeah. One of the more worthless arguments for not calling the penalty was some of the things that we were hearing about. Well, it's a well-poised game with a back and forth. Right. So what, do we just now not give away penalties so that the game stays well-poised? Are you out of your mind? What are we talking about? 100% a penalty. You put your arm out there, you're asking for it.
VAR is spoiling the game, some will say.
Well, they don't know.
I mean, getting a decision correct. I mean, it's like, I don't know. I mean, I'm bemused by particularly former players who are berating referees, some of them, and they're saying, well, you never played the game. I mean, I've always said this. The referees know more about the laws of the game than any of us that ever played, the top ones.
Yeah.
Mm. And Mr. Kuipers, the referee, had a... In fact, we didn't see it live because we were watching two games. So kind of took your eye on the Liverpool game at a minute and all of a sudden missed that. But as soon as the replay came in, there was seven of us in the room, and every man and woman went, that's a penalty.
Yeah.
That's a penalty.
As we look ahead to the second leg now, I think the obvious headline, right, is can Harry Kane play? Mauricio Pochettino has come out and said he could miss basically what's left of the season, apparently, his post-match press conference, and that he fears the worst with this injury. I don't think we can overstate what that does to Spurs' chances, can we?
Well, of course not, and not only in Champions League.
We're talking
about top four as well, and how that comes into question. Now, Spurs have done relatively well without Harry Kane, and I think they'll find a way to deal with it. But dealing with it is not what you want to have at the quarterfinal stage of the Champions League. You want the very best out there. And when you lose without Harry Kane on the field, is the threat of him being able to change a game by either picking out a pass, but more importantly, scoring a big goal, because that's what he brings to Spurs. And so how important would it be to have an away goal for Tottenham against Manchester City? Well, without Harry Kane, it becomes a whole lot more difficult to score that big goal. So clearly, I don't think you can understate and undermine how important this loss is for Spurs.
Steve, you said City needs to play their football.
Yep.
Are you sure that they will, given what we saw today?
Well, the good thing is they don't have any other option. You know, they can't afford to go out and be passive again. They're behind in the tie, so they have to go forward. And they're at home, so we expect them to go forward anyway. So I think it's pretty straightforward for City. They have to get the best players on the field, and that includes Bernardo Silva for me, and go forward and get after Tottenham, because without Harry Kane, that is a huge blow. He can score a goal from absolutely nowhere. Now that threat's gone, there's no reason why City should do anything other than get after it and get going at Tottenham.
Well, there might be another... that injury to Kane might facilitate a bit of a curveball for Guardiola in terms of, there's potential now for Pochettino to change his shape. Because what's the... And his name escapes me. The big fella up front...
Llorente.
Yeah. I don't think... He might play, but I don't think he will. I think one of the things he could do, Pochettino, is go to a back three, get five across the middle with the wing-backs, three in the midfield, and that allows him to get two guys up front, Lucas Moura and Heung-Min Son. So that gives him a little bit of pace up there with Dele Alli supporting. So that, you know, it's probably not the shape he would have gone with Kane in the side, but with him out the side, he's going to have to find a different balance to give them a threat. And they could still go with two up front, and that's still a lot of threat. If City are pushing forward and you've got Moura and Son's pace, that's still a big thing to worry about.
The only problem with that is that 3-5-2 will more than likely become five in the back,
yeah,
and they're going to lose numbers in the midfield. And that's when perhaps Manchester City, with the ability they have, and they find open space in the midfield, it creates all sorts of chances, momentum builds, and then Manchester City scores the goals.
Given Kane injury, and if he's out, who do you think feels better going into the second leg?
Well, Man City for me.
Yeah? Even though they're down?
Yes, at home, can play a lot better. And I still think only Man City can shoot themselves in the foot in this second leg. I mean,
if you'd given Tottenham a 1-0 lead before this game kicked off, they would have went, "I absolutely don't bother playing again."
Correct. Right.
But at the same time, City at home, no Kane, sitting back.
Yeah, well,
City's still the favourites. Yeah.
Manchester City can play a whole lot better than they did today. I don't know how much better Tottenham can play than they did today. And so if they maximize both of their potentials, Manchester City's is much higher than that of Spurs.
Here's a look at Pep Guardiola's record. In the quarterfinals on in Champions League, in the first legs, going all the way back to 2012. And you'll notice not a lot of W's in that result column.
Not any W's.
Away from home. Excuse me, not first. Away from home.